Welcome to The Hindu Current Affairs for Beginners. Let's start our today's session. These are all the topics that we are going to cover in our today's video, and these topics include the topics from yesterday's as well as today's Hindu paper. Due to elections, we didn't do the video, but we don't want our students to miss any of the topics, so we are covering it in today's video. Now let's start our today's session. Our first article is From Theory to Fact. This article comes under GS Paper 3 under the topic of Achievements in Science and Technology. From the prelims point of view, from this article we should know what is meant by a black hole and what is this Event Horizon Telescope. According to an announcement by the researchers at the National Science Foundation, they have captured an image of a black hole and its shadow at the center of a galaxy known as Messier 87. This is the first direct visual evidence that a black hole exists. So now let's see what is this black hole. A black hole is a place in the space where gravity pulls so much, where is so much of gravity pull so that even light cannot get out of it. This is the reason till now we couldn't get an image of a black hole. Here the gravity is so strong, the matter is compressed into a tiny space. Because there is no light that can get out, people can't see black holes. They are invisible. Space telescopes with special tools can help us to find these black holes. The special tools can even see how stars that are very close to the black holes act in a different manner comparing to the other stars. The next thing is, what is this event horizon? There will be a boundary at the edge of a black hole. There will be a boundary, and that is called as event horizon. It is the point of no return. Any light or matter that crosses this boundary will be sucked back into the black hole. So to put it simply, event horizon is the imaginary boundary surrounding the black hole from beyond which the light cannot escape. Then what is this event horizon telescope? It is a network of 10 radio telescopes on 4 continents, and these 10 telescopes, they collectively operate like a single instrument, and they are nearly to the size of Earth. This Event Horizon Telescope project is an international partnership that is formed in 2012 with the objective to directly observe the immediate environment of a black hole, and the findings will provide us the insights into this celestial object, that means this black hole. Now let's see a 2017 prelims question. The terms event horizon, singularity, string theory and standard model are sometimes seen in the news in the context of. Just now we have seen about this event horizon. What we have said? It is the imaginary boundary surrounding the black hole, and beyond this imaginary boundary, light cannot escape. This will not allow the light to escape. Next, we know the nature is governed by 4 fundamental forces. What are they? Electromagnetic forces, strong forces, weak forces, and gravitational forces. This standard model explains these first 3 forces. The next thing is singularity. This singularity constitutes the center of this black hole, and it is hidden by this object's surface. So from the options we can say that the first option is observation and understanding of the universe, study of solar and lunar eclipses, placing satellites in the orbit of the Earth, origin and evolution of the living organisms on the Earth. From this we can say that it is not related to this living organisms or satellites or related to eclipses. It is about observing and understanding the universe. So the answer here is A. The next article is May expresses regret for Jallianwala Bagh firing. This article comes under GS paper 1 under the topic of history, and it also comes under GS paper 2 under the topic of international relations. Here, the British Prime Minister Theresa May, on behalf of the UK government, has said she has shown a long-standing expression of deep regret over the April 1919 Jallianwala Bagh incident and called that massacre as a shameful scar on the British Indian history, but she didn't issue any formal apology for it. From the prelims point of view, here we should know about this Jallianwala Bagh massacre, about this incident. This incident took place on April 13th of 1919. So by tomorrow, it is going to mark the 100th year of this incident took place. It was the Baisakhi that day, a harvest festival that is popular in Punjab and parts of North India. So what happened here is the local residents of Amritsar. This incident took place in Amritsar in a place known as Jallianwala Bagh Garden. So local residents in Amritsar, they decided to hold a meeting that day in order to discuss and protest against the arrest and deportation of two leaders. This is important here. Who are they? It is Satyapal and Saifuddin Kichlu. These two leaders were arrested and deported. So to protest against this arrest and deportation, the local residents on the Baisakhi day, they have decided to hold a meeting in the Jallianwala Bagh garden. The Colonel Reginald Dyer had announced curfew and a ban on all the processions, that even prohibited a group of four or more people to meet publicly. But he sensed these people gathering here and going to conduct a secret meeting. Then he arrived with his armed troops and ordered to open fire. The troops were ordered to start shooting, and that resulted in extreme mass killing. The next article is Reflections on the Massacre. This article comes under GS paper 1 under the topic of history. This article is extension to that article. Then what are the outcomes of this Jallianwala Bagh incident? In this article, there is mention of an act known as Rowlatt Act. Let us see what it is. This act has armed the British government with powers to detain any person without a trial. According to this act, the British government can detain any person without any trial. The two leaders, Satyapal and Saifuddin Kichlu, who were fighting for independence and implementation of this act, were arrested and deported. To protest this arrest, people have gathered in the Jallianwala Bagh garden. Now let's see a prelims question regarding this Rowlatt Act. This question appeared in 2018 UPSC prelims. Who was the Viceroy of India when the Rowlatt Act was passed? The answer is, it is the Lord Chelmsford who is the Viceroy of India when this Rowlatt Act was passed. The next article is Anonymity of Poll Bonds Must Go, says the Election Commission. And this is the article from yesterday's paper. And in today's paper, the voters need not know source of political funding, says the government. These articles comes under the GS paper 2 under the topic of polity, and both these articles are totally related to this electoral bonds. So from the prelims point of view, we should know about this electoral bond scheme. What are these electoral bonds? These electoral bonds are the banking instruments used for funding the eligible political parties. Here I am mentioning eligible political parties. Then what is an eligible political party? A party that is registered under the Representation of People's Act of 1951, and a party that has secured not less than 1% of the votes that were polled in the last general election to the Lok Sabha or the Legislative Assembly. That party will be considered as an eligible party for receiving these electoral bonds. And the validity of these bonds is only 15 days. Then how a political party can encash these bonds? They will have a designated bank account maintained with an authorized bank. They can encash these electoral bonds only in that designated bank account. Then who can purchase these electoral bonds? It is the citizens of India or an entity that is incorporated or established in India. They can only purchase these electoral bonds for funding the political parties. And these bonds were available in the denominations of 1,000, 10,000, 1 lakh, 10 lakhs and 1 crore rupees. So the minimum amount to donate is 1,000 and the maximum is 1 crore. The important things from this scheme are, these are accepted only in Indian rupees. That means here foreign funding is not allowed in case of electoral bonds. They are accepted only in Indian rupees. Only citizens can fund here. And the State Bank of India, SBI, is the sole authorized bank for selling these electoral bonds. The most important thing here is the identity of the donor is not disclosed. It is very confidential. Only the bank that is issuing these electoral bonds will know the identity of the donor. It will not be known to the political parties. The next article is, how can Google Pay operate without authorization? Asks the High Court. This article comes under GS Paper 3 under the topic of economy. Here, the Delhi High Court has asked the Reserve Bank of India to explain how Google Pay was operating its payment services in India without taking any approval or license from the Reserve Bank of India. And this Google Pay, which is also known as Tej App, is using Bheem Unified Payment Interface for money transfer. So here the court says that this Google Pay is acting as a payment system provider, and that is in violation of Payments and Settlements Act of 2007. What is this Payments and Settlements Act of 2007? This act regulates and supervises the payment system in India, and the designated authority for supervising this is the Reserve Bank of India. What is meant by a payment system? A payment system is a system that will enable the payment between a payer and a beneficiary, and this system involves this payment or settlement services or both. Who provides these payment services? Banks as well as non-bank players are the payment service providers in India, whereas the bank-led payment service providers will have direct access to these payment systems. That means enabling the payment between a payer and a beneficiary. Whereas a non-bank payment service providers, they can access this payment system only through a member bank. So to regulate this payments and settlements, this act was enacted, and the authority to regulate this act is the Reserve Bank of India. The other things that were important from this prelims point of view here are NPCI, National Payments Corporation of India. This is the umbrella organization for all the retail payment system in India, and it is promoted by the Reserve Bank of India. It is the umbrella organizations for all the retail payment system, all the retail, just now we have spoken about this payments system. It is the umbrella organization for all the retail payment system in India, and it was founded in 2008 as a non-profit organization, and it is registered under section 25 of Companies Act of 2013. It is this National Payments Corporation of India which has developed a domestic card payment network, which is known as RuPay cards. These are the products of this NPCI, which has reduced the dependency on international card schemes like Visa and MasterCards. The next thing is BHIM. What is this BHIM UPI, Unified Payment Interface? First, let us see about this UPI, Unified Payments Interface. This Unified Payment Interface is a flagship product of this National Payment Corporation of India, just like this RuPay cards. And this will help the country to move towards a cashless economy. And it is a set of standard application programming interface. What will this interface do? This will allow the customers to send and receive money from their smartphones using virtual payment address without entering their bank account details. And this will facilitate a virtual address, this virtual address as a single payment identifier for sending and collecting money, and it works on a single click. Then, what is this BHIM? This is a mobile application. This is an app using which we can transfer money. And this app is based on this NPCI's Unified Payment Interface. It will provide the facility to easily send or receive money from other customers using this interface. It is developed by National Payments Corporation of India, which is the umbrella organization for all retail payment systems in India. BHIM means Bharat Interface for Money. Now let's see a previous year prelims question. This is a 2018 prelims question. Which one of the following links all the ATMs in India? It is the National Payments Corporation of India that links all the ATMs in India. The next article is Trickeries of Money Bill. This article comes under GS Paper 2 under the topic of polity. The Supreme Court has recently heard oral arguments in Revenue Bar Association versus Union of India, in which the validity of the Finance Act of 2017 is challenged. The detailed analysis of this editorial was done by Rambabu sir in his deep video yesterday. But here, as our core video is meant for learning the basics, so as this entire article is about finance bill, let us know what is a finance bill and then what is a money bill. First, the finance bills are the legislative proposals that will be presented in Lok Sabha before the beginning of every financial year and after the budget announcement for the next financial year. These financial bills, they essentially serve the purpose for all the amendments that need to be made to various acts to implement the budget in the coming financial year. These bills are meant to bring some amendments to various acts like Income Tax Act to implement the budget in the financial year, coming financial year. Next, let us see what is this money bill. Under Article 110 of the Indian Constitution, a bill is considered as a money bill if it contains only the provisions that deal with, as I said, a bill will be considered as a money bill only if it deals with the provisions that were listed in this Article 110. They are imposition, abolition, remission, alteration or regulation of any act. This is one provision. The regulation of borrowing of money or giving of any guarantee by the government of India, and the custody of consolidated fund or contingency fund of India, and the appropriation of money out of consolidated fund of India or declaring any expenditure that is charged on the consolidated fund of India, or the receipt of money on account of consolidated fund year. Here, expenditure and receipt and any other proposed legislation that have certain features to be classified as a money bill. So only the bill that deals with these provisions will be considered as a money bill under Article 110 of the Indian Constitution. Then who will decide whether the bill is a money bill or not? It is the Speaker of Lok Sabha who decides whether the bill is a money bill or not. And this decision of Speaker is not subjected to any judicial review. That means it cannot be questioned in any court of law. Now let's see in detail about this money bill by going through our previous year's prelims questions. Which one of the following statements about a money bill is not correct? A money bill cannot be tabled in either house of the parliament. The Speaker of Lok Sabha is the final authority to decide whether a money bill is a money bill or not. Just now we have seen this. This is correct. Here the question is, which is not correct? The Rajya Sabha must return a money bill passed by Lok Sabha and send it for reconsideration within 14 days. The President cannot return a money bill to the Lok Sabha for reconsideration. This question is dealing with the procedure for passing the money bill. We have seen what is a money bill and who will say whether the bill is a money bill or not. It is the Speaker. So now let's see what is the procedure for passing this money bill. This money bill can be introduced or originated only in Lok Sabha. I repeat it, this can be tabled only in Lok Sabha but not in either house of the parliament. From this itself we can see the first statement is incorrect. And this money bill can be introduced only with the recommendation of the president. Whereas in case of a state government, it is with the recommendation of the governor. And it can be a government bill only and it cannot be a private bill. That means it has to be introduced by the minister but not by a private member. And once a money bill is passed in the Lok Sabha, this has to be sent to Rajya Sabha for its consideration. But Rajya Sabha has limited powers in this. The Rajya Sabha cannot reject or amend the money bill. It can neither reject nor amend it. It can only make recommendations and it should return the bill with or without recommendations to the Lok Sabha in 14 days. So even this statement is correct. Now, the Lok Sabha may or may not accept the recommendations of Rajya Sabha. Whether or not accepted those recommendations, the return bill will be considered as passed in both the houses. If Rajya Sabha doesn't return the bill in 14 days also, then it will be considered as passed in both the houses. Now, the money bill is passed in both the houses. Next, it goes to the president. The president can withhold his assent, but he cannot return the bill for reconsideration of Lok Sabha. I repeat it, he can withhold his assent, he cannot give his assent, but he cannot return it for reconsideration of Lok Sabha. So from this, even this statement is correct. And another thing that is important in case of money bill is, in case of any difference of opinion in between Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha, there will be no joint sitting. No joint sitting will be held in case of money bills because here the opinion of Rajya Sabha is immaterial. Even though their recommendations were accepted or not, it will be passed by the Lok Sabha. So the answer here is A, which is incorrect. A money bill can be tabled in either house of the parliament. This statement is incorrect because it can be tabled only in Lok Sabha. The next question is, who decides whether a bill is a money bill or not? It is the Speaker of Lok Sabha. The next question is, what will follow if a money bill is substantially amended by the Rajya Sabha? The Lok Sabha may still proceed with the bill, accepting or not accepting the recommendations of Rajya Sabha. The Lok Sabha cannot consider the bill further. The Lok Sabha may send the bill to Rajya Sabha for reconsideration. The President may call a joint sitting for passing the bill. We have seen that there is no joint sitting in case of money bill, and Lok Sabha, it cannot consider the bill further. Here this statement is wrong because even though Rajya Sabha has given some recommendations, this might be accepted or might not be accepted by Lok Sabha. The bill will be passed. So this statement is incorrect, and Lok Sabha may send the bill for reconsideration. This will not happen. Lok Sabha will proceed with the bill, whether accepting or not accepting the recommendations of Rajya Sabha. So the answer here is A. The next question is, regarding money bill, which of the following statements is not correct? This is a 2018 question. A bill shall be deemed to a money bill if it contains only provisions relating to imposition, abolition, remission, alteration, or regulation of any tax. A money bill has provisions for the custody of Consolidated Fund of India or Contingency Fund of India. Or a money bill is concerned with the appropriation of money out of Contingency Fund of India. A money bill deals with the regulation of borrowing of money or giving of any guarantee by the Government of India. While seeing about what is a money bill, according to Article 110 of the Indian Constitution, we have seen what all the provisions that will be dealt by a money bill. So here, a money bill is concerned with the appropriation of monies out of Contingency Fund of India is not a provision under Article 110 of the Constitution. So the answer here is C. The other questions are, no money bill can be introduced in the Legislative Assembly without the recommendations of the Governor. Here the question is, it cannot be introduced in the Legislative Assembly without the recommendations of Governor. Whereas at the national level, the recommendation of President, prior recommendation of President to introduce it is needed. Rajya Sabha can delay the money bill passed by Lok Sabha for a period not exceeding, the answer here is 14 days. It has to return it with or without recommendation without 14 days. If it doesn't return it within 14 days, even then the bill will be considered as passed by both the houses of the parliament. So the answer here is B. The next article is forcing China's hand. This article comes under GS paper 2 under the topic of international relations. And this entire article is all about the United Nations initiative to list Jaish-e-Mohammed's founder Masood Azhar in the United Nations Security Council as a designated terrorist. So from this article, now from the prelims point of view, we should know about this United Nations Security Council and what is this 1267 resolution of UNSC. First, let us see about United Nations Security Council. It is one of the six principal organs of United Nations. And what it does is, it is the responsibility of this Security Council to maintain international peace and security. In order to maintain international peace and security, it has the powers to establish peacekeeping operations. It can start some peacekeeping operations to maintain peace and security, and it can establish international sanctions. Sanctions against any organizations or individuals that are threat to the peace and security, and it can even authorize military action. They exercise, the United Nations Security Council will exercise its powers through resolutions, by passing the resolutions, UNSC resolutions they are known as. And this Security Council consists of 15 members, out of which 10 are non-permanent and 5 are the permanent members. Who are these permanent members? China, UK, US, France and Russia. These are the 5 permanent members, and these permanent members were having a veto power. That means if there is any difference of opinion, or if any member out of these 5 permanent members is not in line with the decision taken by this committee, 15 member UNSC, then that, using its veto power, the permanent member can pass a technical hold. It can put a technical hold to that decision. So once a permanent member uses its veto to put a technical hold to any decision, that matter will not come in front of this UNSC till 3 more months. Only after 3 months again this matter should be brought in front of this United Nations Security Council. And these 10 non-permanent members will be elected on a regional basis, and they serve for 2-year term. And the presidency of this UNSC will rotate monthly among its 15 members. Now, what is this United Nations 1267 resolution? This resolution initially dealt with both Al-Qaeda and Taliban. And this resolution has established a UNSC 1267 committee. And this committee looked after both Al-Qaeda and Taliban issues. Later, this has split and it created a new Taliban sanctions committee to separately deal with Taliban. Right now, this 1267 is only dealing with the sanction measures that will be applied to the designated individuals and entities that are associated with Al-Qaeda. So what will happen if they are listed under this UNSC 1267 list? If an individual or a terrorist organization is included in this list, it will help in restricting their movement and imposing financial penalties on them and freezing their assets. It will impose a travel ban, freezing their assets and impose financial penalties. And this committee also consists of 15 members of this UNSC, where the permanent members were having a veto power to put technical hold to any decision. So if a single member opposes, there will be no consensus. This is why China's opposition to India's bid is not allowing this UNSC to designate Masood Azhar, the Jaish-e-Mohammed founder, and also the recent Pulwama attack happened, right? The Jaish-e-Mohammed has took responsibility for that attack. So India is asking UNSC to designate Masood Azhar as an international terrorist and freeze his assets. But China is opposing it and it had put a technical hold over it. Now let's see a question regarding this UNSC. Which one of the following statements regarding the veto power in the Security Council is correct according to the United Nations Charter? The decisions of the Security Council on all non-procedural matters must be made by an affirmative vote of 9 members, including the concurring votes of permanent members of the Council. Every permanent member of Security Council can prevent any decision from being accepted by vetoing to it. The term veto was used in Article 27 of UN Charter to enable any permanent member of the Security Council to prevent any resolution from being passed by majority. Any member of the Security Council can prevent any resolution from being passed by voting against it. So the first statement is the decisions must be made by an affirmative vote of 9 members is what it is saying, including concurring votes of permanent members of the council. No, any decision, it needs the 15 members approval. Even if one member out of this 15, 5 are permanent, only 5 are having this veto power. So the first statement is incorrect. And here the third statement is it has to be passed with a majority to prevent any resolution from being passed by majority. It is not this way. And the last statement is any member can prevent any resolution. No, not all the members were having this veto power, only 5 permanent members. Every permanent member of Security Council can prevent any decision from being accepted by vetoing to it. So the second statement is correct. The answer here is B. The next article is gubernatorial impropriety. This article comes under GS paper 2 under the topic of polity and governance. This entire article is dealing with the institution of governor. Now let us see about this governor. Governor is the state executive head. He is the head of state executive, chief executive head of state. What are the qualifications that were required to become a governor? Age has to be 35 years and he or she should be a citizen of India. And the governor will be appointed by the president by warrant under his hand and seal. Even though the governor holds the office for 5 years, this is a term, but there is no security of term or tenure. This has to be remembered. There is no security of term or tenure for governor because he will enjoy the office until the pleasure of the president. He is appointed by him and he can even be removed by the president even before the tenure. And governor of the state is not an employment under the central government. It is not an employment under the central government. A person can act as a governor for 2 or more states. a state and also a union territory. At a time, a governor can act as governor for two or more states and also a state and union territory. While administering this union territory, he will act as an agent to the president. As governor of the state, he will be the head of the constitution. We said that the president will appoint the governor by consulting the chief minister of that state. The president will appoint him. An outsider will be appointed as a governor. The questions can come from that area, and also there is possibility of questions from the area of powers of the governor. Like president, even the governor enjoys the executive powers, legislative powers, financial powers and judicial powers. Let us see all these. Executive powers: in appointing the state election commissioner, and in case of universities, he will act as chancellor of the universities in that state, and also it is he who imposes the constitutional emergency in a state. And when it comes to the legislative powers, he nominates 1/6 of the members of state legislative council and one member of Anglo-Indian community. The next is judicial powers. In case of financial powers, we have said that the prior recommendation of governor is required for passing, for introducing a money bill. Judicial powers. Article 163 states that governor can act in his discretion while exercising the functions, whether the matter is in the governor discretion or not, that will be decided by the governor itself. What is the jurisdiction of governor will be decided by himself according to Article 163, and that cannot be questioned in any court of law. There is a 42nd amendment that made the ministerial advice that is binding on the president, whereas this provision is not there for the governor. So the governor enjoys both constitutional as well as situational discretion. Now let's see some of the previous year prelims questions with regard to the governor. As per Indian protocol, who among the following ranks highest in the order of precedence? Here, if we see the order of precedence, the first comes president, followed by vice president, followed by the prime minister of India, and then governors of the various states, followed by former prime presidents, and then comes the deputy prime minister. Now if we look into the options here, in case of order of precedence, the governor of states within his state is in the fourth place, whereas the former presidents comes after him in fifth place, and the deputy prime minister comes after these former presidents under 5A, and then comes the speaker of Lok Sabha along with the CJI in sixth rank. So the answer here is C, governor of state within his state ranks highest in the order of precedence. The next question is, Article 156 of the Constitution of India provides that a governor shall hold office for a tenure of 5 years from the date on which he enters upon his office. Which of the following can be deduced from this? No governor can be removed from office till the completion of his term, and no governor can continue in office beyond 5 years. See, we have said that though the term of governor is 5 years, but he can hold the office only until the pleasure of president. That means he can be removed by the president even before the term. So both the statements are incorrect. So the answer here is D, neither one nor two. The next question is, which of the following are the discretionary powers given to the governor of a state? Sending a report to the president of India for imposing the president rule. Yes, the governor will send a report to the president for imposing a president rule in that state, and in appointing the ministers, reserving certain bills passed by the state legislature for the consideration of President of India. This comes under Article 200, where the governor can reserve certain bills that were passed by the state legislature for consideration of the president. And making the rules to the conduct of the business, to conduct the business of the state government. Here, the governor will not have any role in appointing the ministers. It is the chief minister who will appoint his minister, and it is the legislative assembly which will make the rules to conduct the business of the state governments, but not the governor. He will not have any discretionary power here. So as only 1 and 3 are correct, the answer here is B, 1 and 3 only. The next question is, please ignore this. The question is, consider the following statements. With regard to the governor of a state, which of the following is correct? In India, the same person cannot be appointed as a governor for two or more states at the same time. The statement is incorrect. We have seen just now, a person can be appointed as a governor for two or more states, and also for a state and a union territory. While administering the union territory, he will act as an agent of the president. The judges of High Court of the states in India are appointed by the governor of the state, just like the judges of Supreme Court are appointed by the president. Even this statement is incorrect, because here the judges, the CJA and the other judges, were appointed by the president in case of Supreme Court. Yes, and the other judges were appointed by the president by consulting the collegium. Whereas in case of High Courts, the judges were appointed by the president only, but he consults the Chief Justice of India and governor in appointing those judges. So the second statement is incorrect. The next question is, no procedure has been laid down in the Constitution of India for the removal of governor from his or her post. This statement is correct, because there is no provision. The Constitution didn't lay down any grounds based on which a governor can be removed by the president. So, as the question is, which of the following statements is correct? The answer here is C. Sorry for the key, it is C. In case of a union territory having a legislative setup, the chief minister is appointed by the lieutenant governor on the basis of majority support. Yes, in a union territory, the chief minister will be appointed by the lieutenant governor based on the majority support. The next question is, consider the following statements. No criminal proceedings shall be instituted against the governor of a state in any court during his term of office. The emoluments and allowances of the governor of a state shall not be diminished during his term of office. Yes, no criminal proceeding should be instituted against him when he is serving his office. And the emoluments and allowance should not be decreased when he is serving. So as both the statements are correct, the answer here is C, both 1 and 2. The next article is, high stock of non-performing assets in India, more progress needed, says the International Monetary Fund. Here, this article comes under GS Paper 3 under the topic of economy. According to the IMF, the level of non-performing loans in India are very high. What are these non-performing assets? Loans are considered as an asset to a bank because they will bring profits in the form of interest. So this loan will be considered as a non-performing asset if this loan will not provide any return on its investment. That is, if the capital or the interest is not paid back to the bank within 90 days, then that loan will be considered as a non-performing asset. So the IMF is saying that the level of these non-performing loans is very high. And this article is talking about a program known as Financial Sector Assessment Program. What is this Financial Sector Assessment Program? This is a joint program of IMF and World Bank. This was launched in 1999 in the wake of Asian financial crisis. This program brings together this IMF and World Bank expertise, that is their skilled workforce, to help the countries reduce the severity of financial sector crisis. How they do that? By providing a framework through which the authorities in the participating countries, they will be able to identify the vulnerabilities in their financial system. And this framework, which the expertise of IMF and World Bank has provided, will help the authorities in the participating countries to identify the vulnerabilities and develop appropriate policy responses to those vulnerabilities. We have seen in the news that the Indian government is recapitalization of banks. It is capitalizing the banks. So, strengthening the level of this capitalization in banks is one of the recommendations under this financial sector assessment program for India. All this was told in the backdrop of the release of a global financial stability report of International Monetary Fund. This is important. The next article is India stares at a pile of solar e-waste. This article comes under GS paper 3 under the topic of infrastructure. A recent study by energy consultancy firm known as Bridge to India. They have estimated that India's photovoltaic waste volume might grow to 1.8 million tons by 2050. And this study has said there is a need of an urgent policy for solar waste management, and there is a need for standards for use of environmentally sustainable material for manufacturing. What is that? It is to manufacture these solar modules. There is a need for environmentally sustainable material and also the standards and new policy to manage this solar module waste. From the prelims point of view, we should know what is the solar e-waste and what are these solar cell modules. These solar cell modules, they are composed of glass, aluminium and potentially hazardous materials like lead compounds, polymers, cadmium compounds. So when these are disposed, then they can have a negative environmental and health impacts. The next article is a crisis that raises hasty solutions. This article comes under GS paper 2 under the topic of international relations. This entire article is about the delay in the Brexit, British exit from European Union. So from the prelims point of view, we should know what is Brexit, what is European Union, what is the customs union and backstop arrangement that were mentioned in this article. Brexit, this is an abbreviation for British exit from the European Union. What is European Union? European Union is a political, trade and economic union that is founded in 1957. But its present model was evolved through an outcome of Single European Act of 1991. It has 28 European countries as part of it out of 51 countries in Europe. And this entire European Union accounts for 16% of the world's imports and exports, and it is the largest trading bloc in the world. The next thing is, let us see what is this customs union. In customs union, the partner countries can decide to trade at zero duty among themselves. There are two countries, they can decide they wanted to trade at zero duty, but they maintain common tariffs against the rest of the world. These two countries will trade at zero duty, but they will maintain common, they both will maintain same tariff rates for other countries. Now let's see what is this backstop arrangement. We know that UK and Ireland, they are part of European Union Single Market and Customs Union. First of all, this Republic of Ireland is an independent country and it is an European Union member, whereas the Northern Ireland is an autonomous territory within the United Kingdom. Both UK and Ireland are part of European Union Single Market as well as Customs Union. So products, they need not be inspected for customs and standards if they are traded between these two nations. But after Brexit, That is, if UK exits from European Union, then the two parts of Ireland can be in different customs and regulatory regimes, which means the products will be checked at the border. So the UK government doesn't want this to happen. So here comes this backstop arrangement. This backstop is an arrangement to maintain an open border on the island of Ireland. This will allow the flow of goods between Northern Ireland and Republic of Ireland without checking the goods at the borders. The next article is India's anti-satellite test, a game changer. This article comes under GS Paper 3 under the topic of science and technology. So this entire article is analyzing about the anti-satellite test that was conducted by India recently. India has successfully testified anti-satellite missile by shooting down a live satellite which is known as MicroSat-R. It is an imaging satellite located in the lower Earth orbit. So from the prelims point of view, we should know about this anti-satellite test, which is named as Mission Shakti. What is anti-satellite test? It is the capability of a satellite to hit and destroy the satellite that is in the space through a missile launched from the ground. The first anti-satellite test was carried out by US military in 1959. Later it was followed by both Soviet Union and China. And India is the fourth country to carry out this anti-missile test. It is a capability to hit and destroy the satellite in space through the missiles launched from the ground. The next article is Sudan President Bashir ousted by armed forces. This article comes under GS Paper 2 under the topic of international relations. Here, the Sudan president was arrested by the armed forces. From this article, here there is mention of International Criminal Court. He was arrested here because he was facing allegations for his role in the genocide in Sudan's Darfur region that led to the death of nearly 3 lakh people. Then the International Criminal Court, which is located in Hague, has ordered an arrest warrant against Mr. Bashir. Now, let's see about this International Criminal Court. This court is located in Hague of Netherlands. This court is considered as a last resort for prosecuting genocide, war crimes and crimes against humanity. And it is the first permanent treaty-based international criminal court that is established to help in ending the impunity, that is saving from the punishment for committing most serious crimes that are of the concern to the international community, like war crimes, genocides and crimes against humanity. This International Criminal Court was founded based on a treaty known as Rome Statute, and it entered into force in 2002. This court has jurisdiction to prosecute individuals for international crimes of this genocide, crimes against humanity and war crimes. Only thing is, here it is intended to complement our existing national judicial systems. Every country is having a judiciary, but this International Criminal Court is a supplement to that in order to exercise its jurisdiction in cases of this genocides and war crimes. This is all for today, and see you all in tomorrow's video. Thank you.